Good morning, and please be seated. So good to see you. Stop. How much is, take your Bibles, would you, or your copy of God's Word, and turn to Acts chapter 28. We're going to look at verse 23 through verse 31. And guess what? We're at the end of the book of Acts. We beat Jesus coming back. Did you ever think we'd make it? 3 years. Can I tell you what's happening next? Next week, we have the privilege to have Matt Henderson here from Rhodey Christian Fellowship down at the University of Rhode Island. He's going to be sharing with us about his ministry, and we'll have an opportunity to support him and encourage him with that work. The following week, you'll see that our candidate for associate pastor will be coming, and that week he will be preaching. And you'll get to hear his heart as he shares from God's word. And then the following week, I'm going to do a series of studies on spiritual gifts. I'm going to be teaching on that specific topic. And then after that, we're done with that, we're going to move into the topic of elders and what that looks like in a church. And then following that, we're going to go into the book of Amos. And then maybe Jesus will be back. Verse 28, or chapter 28, verse 23. Now remember, Paul's in Rome. This is the end of his ministry. He is under supervision by the Roman guards, and he seems to have some freedom to receive guests. And at this time, some of the Jews come, and they want to listen to his teaching. So after arranging a day with him, and he came to him at his lodging, from dawn to dusk, he expounded and testified about the kingdom of God. He tried to persuade them about Jesus from both the law of Moses and the prophets. Some were persuaded by what he said, but others did not believe. Disagreeing among themselves, they began to leave after Paul made this statement. The Holy Spirit was right in saying to your ancestors through the prophet Isaiah when he said, go to these people and say, you will always be listening but never understanding. You will always be looking but never perceiving. For the hearts of these people have grown callous. Their ears are hard of hearing and they have shut their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears, understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. Therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will listen. Paul stayed 2 whole years in his own rented house, and he welcomed all who visited him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness, without hindrance. Now, I want you to notice in this passage, I don't know if we can all get up there or not, but if we go back up to verse 23, this passage begins with Paul all day long expounding and testifying about the kingdom of God. Now, if you go down to verse 31, you'll read that at the conclusion of this passage, he welcomed all who visited him and he proclaimed the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not the brightest light on the Christmas tree, but I'm thinking this passage is going to have to say something about the kingdom of God. Now, what's also interesting, does this passage have the parameters of the kingdom of God? But the entire book does. If you will, have you turn to Acts chapter 1, beginning with verse 3. Speaking about Jesus, it said, after he suffered, he also presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. So the book of Acts begins with the kingdom of God. It ends with the kingdom of God. And while he was with them, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for the Father's promise, which he said, you have heard me speak about, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized by the Holy Spirit in a few days. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, are you restoring the kingdom of Israel at this time? And he said to them, it's not for you to know times or periods that my Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. 40 days after Jesus was raised from the dead, he spent teaching his disciples about the kingdom of God. Now, I'm thinking that would be a very interesting time of Bible study. Even after the 40 days, their comprehension remained clouded until the day of Pentecost. I believe what we have in the book of Acts and the rest of the New Testament is Jesus' teaching of the kingdom of God through the apostles, through his prophets, by the power of the Holy Spirit. My conclusion is this, that Jesus came as a savior and prophet. He came as Israel's Messiah to bring deliverance. Yes, he also announced the kingdom of God in a very prophetic fashion. But he went beyond just the announcement of the kingdom of God. He went much further. The testimony of the gospel and the rest of the New Testament writers point clearly that Jesus, as the Messiah and the Savior, came and gave his life on the cross, rose from the dead, and now is seated at the right hand of God. And he sits, and he rules, and he reigns as king. And the means by which others, you and I, enter the kingdom of God. This morning, I am going to humbly attempt to share three aspects of the kingdom of God that I found in these verses that I read here at the end of the book of Acts. For you see, all week, in the prior 2 weeks while I was on vacation, my head has been exploding with the teachings of the kingdom of God. I have read extensively. I read 5 books while I was away. I read the Bible. My head is like Kevin's this morning. It's everywhere. Sorry, Kevin, but you were. And so now I'm trying to narrow it down to these three things in 30 minutes. So, Father, first I want to thank you for the privilege of being part of the kingdom of God. And thank you for this opportunity to bless your people with its teachings. I want to be useful to you. But now, Father, we come once again to lift our voices, to tune our hearts, and to prepare ourselves for this privilege to exalt your name and to give you praise. Be honored and glorified through our singing. May it be a sweet aroma to you, our great God and our Savior. It's in your name that I pray. Amen. In the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord seated on a high and lofty throne, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphim were standing above him. They each had 6 wings. With 2, they covered their faces. With 2, they covered their feet. With 2, they flew, and one called out to another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of armies. His glory fills the whole earth." The foundations of the doorway shook at the sound of his voice, their voices, and the temple was filled with smoke. Then I said, "Woe is me, for I am ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And because my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of armies." Then one of the seraphim flew to me and in his hand was a glowing coal that he had taken from the altar with tongs. He touched my mouth with it and said, now this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is removed and your sin is atoned for. Then I heard the voice of the Lord asking, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? Play it again, would you? Exalt thee. Morning, as best we know how, to worship you. But even like in the day of Isaiah, when a nation was troubled at the loss of a king, the king was still seated on his throne. Thank you for that promise. Regardless of what we go through or are going through, you are seated on the throne. And our confidence is in you. And we praise you for who you are and thank you for what you've done. And look forward to the days ahead that your kingdom will come on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Please be seated. All right, number one. I said 30 minutes, right? Number one, the invitation into God's kingdom. The first thing I thought about is the invitation of into God's kingdom, especially there at the beginning of this passage, where the reference is concerning the teachings about Jesus, how Paul spent time connecting the dots for the Jews from the Old Testament into what they were experiencing now and hearing about the testimonies of Jesus. So after arranging a day with him, many came to him at his lodging from dusk to dawn. He expounded and testified about the kingdom of God, and he tried to persuade them about Jesus, both in the law of Moses and the prophets. Some were persuaded, and others didn't believe. Now, number one, underneath the invitation to God's kingdom, there has to be a transfer of citizenship. You see, the Jews were under the impression that because they were physical descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that they were automatically going to become part of God's kingdom when it was established. But Jesus told them because of their sin, they were from Satan's kingdom, the kingdom of darkness. Jesus offered them an opportunity to be free, from that kingdom of darkness. He said, if you hold to my teachings, you will know the truth. And he said, the truth will set you free. What Jesus did for us is this. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, he rescued us. Because every single one of us were trapped in the dominion of darkness. The rule and reign of Satan. He controlled every one of us. But Jesus offered us freedom. And he has brought us and transformed us into the kingdom, his son, of the son he loves. That's exciting to me. And I was part of the kingdom of darkness like every single one of us. And he's offered us a transfer of membership, citizenship. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, God chose Israel as his special people. He says this about you and me, using the same language he used about Israel. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belong for his possession, so that you may declare proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. In Luke chapter 4, verse 43, but he said to them, it is necessary for me to proclaim the good news about the kingdom of God to other towns also, because Jesus said, I was sent for this purpose, to proclaim the kingdom of God. Now, if you ask a group of Christians, why did Jesus come? Very few would probably say Jesus came to proclaim the kingdom of God. Many of us would say Jesus came to sacrifice his life so that you and I might know God's forgiveness. Some might say Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. Some might say Jesus came to serve and not to be served. Jesus came proclaiming the kingdom of God. But even more than that, he came in proclaiming the kingdom of God that he would be the one to take away their sins. The removal of sin is necessary so people can live in the kingdom. And he made it possible for that to happen. Without the death and resurrection of Jesus, the kingdom of God would not be accessible. Jesus saw himself as commissioned to preach that good news, and that's exactly what he did, and he provided the way for us into the kingdom. In Romans chapter 14, verse 17, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but it is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit, because we know that now we are right with God and we are citizens of the kingdom. That'll get us excited. There we go. Number two, obviously, it's through Jesus. Now, I'm not referring to the man Jesus, just the man Jesus, nor the teacher Jesus, nor the miracle worker Jesus. I am referring to the Jesus who is highly exalted as the King, the one who has been given name above every name. I am talking about Jesus, who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's the King. That's the Jesus. That is the one through whom each one of us have been offered the privilege of entering the kingdom of God. Paul stood up in Acts chapter 13, beginning with verse 16, and motioned with his hand and said, fellow Israelites, and you who fear God, listen. The God of this people, Israel, chose our ancestors, made the people prosper during their stay in the land of Egypt, and let them out of it with a mighty arm. And for about 40 years he put up with them in the wilderness, and after destroying seven nations in the land of Canaan, he gave them their land as an inheritance. This all took about 450 years. After this, he gave them judges until Samuel the prophet. Then they asked for a king. And God gave him Saul, the son of Kish, a man in the tribe of Benjamin, for 40 years. After removing him, he raised up David as their king and testified about him. I have found David, the son of Jesse, to be a man after my own heart who will carry out all of my will. Now listen and read. From this man's descendants, as he promised, God brought to Israel the Savior, Jesus, the King, the Messiah, the Lord, the one who will rule and reign forever. And it was through his death, as Psalm 53 tells us, as Psalm 2 tells us. His coronation took place as a result of his sacrifice, him laying down his life, and him rising again. He is the king who sits on the throne of David, is the one through whom each are given permission and through whom each are able to come into the kingdom of God. Number three, turning from sin and self. You see, when you enter the kingdom of God, things just don't stay the same. You have to be willing to turn away from the way you've been trying to run your life. Turning from your sin and self, and you come trusting Jesus. So it's a 180 degree turn. My life in the kingdom of darkness goes this way, away from God. Jesus offers me the opportunity to turn to repentance and to follow him in God's glory, in God's way. The stimulus for the kingdom expectation came from Daniel's 70-week prophecy located in Daniel 9. You see, the Jews went into exile because of sin. Therefore, repentance was the key if it was going to end. John the Baptist added one small word to his kingdom announcement which is often overlooked. Look, he said this in his announcements in Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, because the kingdom of heaven has come near." For he is the one spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, who said, "A voice of the one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord and make his path straight." We cannot live the same way that we used to live and walk in the ways of Jesus. We have to repent and turn from it. See, the arrival of the Messiah meant that this was a long-awaited kingdom was at hand. It was within reach. John's message started with repentance, and it was intended to prepare the people for the more radical teachings that Jesus was going to share. See, the preaching of Jesus caught most people off guard. They thought the Messiah would free them from the bonds of Rome and reintroduce the glorious times of Israel. But Jesus came preaching a spiritual kingdom, about a supernatural experience that they would understand and experience God's forgiveness. And when he did that, and he wasn't on page with them, trouble was a-brewing. And things got difficult. After John was arrested in Mark chapter 1, verses 14 and 50, Jesus went to Galilee proclaiming the good news. The time has been fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come. Repent and believe in the good news. Luke chapter 16, verse 16, the law and the prophets were until John. Since then, the good news of the kingdom has been proclaimed and everyone has been invited to enter it. Luke informs us that the transition between the old and the new has taken place, that the kingdom of God had come. Paul teaches how the kingdom of God relates to conversion. See, we believe that Jesus is God's son, and that he rose from the dead, and we receive deliverance from the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of light. And this kingdom is the present reality. The change of dominions from darkness to the kingdom Jesus brings is about a rescue. He rescues us. People are certainly in need of rescue. People are in need of the message of Jesus and his kingdom. You know, about a month ago, beginning on June 23rd, 12 young boys and their coach were trapped in a cave in Thailand. It took about 10,000 workers. Over a period of many days, eventually on July 8th through 10th, the boys were rescued along with their coach. That story gripped our nation. It gripped the world. And I'm thinking, there has been a much better rescue that's taken place than that. You and I were in a far worse place than stuck in a cave, unable to get out. We were all stuck in the kingdom of darkness. Our eyes were blinded to the truth. There were nothing we could capably do to change our course. And Jesus did it for us. He changes the hearts, people. He changes the person within. Let me remind you, he is not interested in changing your circumstances. He's interested in changing your heart. Number two, with all that good news, you think, wow, that's exciting. I'd like to be part of that rescue. I'd like to be rescued. But unfortunately, it's not the case. Number two, the rejection of God's kingdom. I want you to notice the character of rejection. Look at verse 25, the first part. It says they were disagreeing among themselves. Some of them decided that this is nonsense, and others believed. And then they broke away and they just started disagreeing with one another. Luke chapter 2, verse 34. When they brought Jesus to the temple when he was being committed to the Lord, Simeon blessed them, Mary and Joseph, and told his mother Mary, "Indeed, this child is destined to cause the fall and rise of many in Israel and to be a sign that's going to be opposed." When Jesus came into this world, he caused the division between those who are his and those who are not. Those who respond by faith and trusting him and those who reject it. Jesus even said in Luke chapter 12, verse 49, "I came to bring fire on the earth. And how I wish it were already set ablaze, but I have a baptism to undergo, and how it consumes me until it's finished. Do you think that I came here to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, five in a household will be divided, three against two, and two against three. They will be divided, father against son, son against father, mother against daughter, daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. That does not sound like harmony. And when Jesus comes into a person's life, they become so distinctly different. The kingdom they enter is a kingdom of light, and it contrasts the kingdom of darkness in such a way that two cannot coexist. And one of the characteristics of those who are inside the kingdom and outside the kingdom is that they don't get along. And there's division. Jesus said in Mark chapter 3, if a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided itself, cannot stand. If Israel has now met their Messiah, and there he was before them. And some chose to believe that he is the Messiah. Others rejected him. I will guarantee you this, that that house is going to fall. And oh, Israel did fall. In AD 70, everything they held near and dear to them was destroyed. And no longer could they practice their religion. In Acts chapter 2, we can see the distinction between Israel, who believed, and Israel, who rejected. In Acts chapter 2, verse 37, when Peter was preaching, and when they heard this about how they were the ones who actually killed Jesus, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" And many of them believed, they repented and believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, and they were baptized, and their souls were saved. Not all of them. In chapter 7, when Stephen is preaching, in verse 51, after he explains the whole history of Israel and how Jesus came as God's Messiah and King and came to bring the kingdom, he said this to them, "You stiff-necked people," when they wouldn't listen, "who with uncircumcised hearts and ears, how you're always resisting the Holy Spirit as your ancestors did, you do also. Which of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? They even killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one, whose betrayers and murderers you have now become. You received the law under the direction of angels and yet have not kept it." Then they heard these things and were enraged and gnashed their teeth at him. Do you see the clear division in the nation Israel? Let me remind you, congregation, a body of believers that sold out to the Lord Jesus Christ cannot be divided. It has got to have the characteristics of unity if it's going to survive. Complete unity. Not just in this area or that area, but together as one man, the Bible says. That we have the same mind, the same heart, the same Holy Spirit, making us all one. Because if we're not, there's a characteristic here that tells us rejection has been part of our experience rather than acceptance. Let me show you number two, the consequence of rejection. They begin in verse 20, latter part, to leave after Paul made one statement. The Holy Spirit was right in saying to your ancestors through the prophet Isaiah, when he said, "Go to these people and say, you will always be listening but never understanding, and you will always be looking but never perceiving. The heart of these people have grown callous. Their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them." I'll tell you what Jesus wanted to do with Israel. We find that in Matthew chapter 23, beginning with verse 37. When Jesus approached Israel, he said, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her? How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wing, but you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate." Chapter 21, verse 43, Jesus says these words, "Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruit." My, oh my, do I want to be those people. I want to see the work of God so happen in this body of believers that we will see the fruit, the evidence of the kingdom of God, of God's people sold out to him and one another for his glory and his purpose. Because if we don't, there are some clear warnings in here. If you back up to verse 25 and verse 26, notice what Paul says about Israel. He says to them, "Your ancestors." He's not even including himself this time. And then he says, from Isaiah, he says these words, "Go to these people." That's even worse. If Paul has now come to the place where he has disconnected himself with Israel, let me tell you what God did with Israel. He called them these people. Hosea, a man who married Gomer, not a very nice girl, not one you want to bring home to mom and dad. God said, "Marry her." And then he has kids. First one's no compassion, that's its name. In verse 9, the second child comes. And they named him loame. For you are not my people. And I will not be your God. I have no idea how you take that. As a person who so desires to be of God and to be connected with Him and to hear those words, I'm not your God. But here's the good news. Yet the number of the Israelites will be like the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured or counted. And in the place where they were told, you are not my people, they will be called sons of the living God. I take that as all of Israel. I understand that as every person who comes to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior becomes part of the family and people of God. So I will sing that song with the kids. Father Abraham had many sons. That's who I am. That's who you are. You have, and I have been grafted in to the family of God. We are His. The sad part is, it took Israel's disobedience for that to happen. So I want you to see next the direction of God's kingdom. It is for those who will listen. It's for those who will listen. Therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will what? They'll listen. We listen. In Romans chapter 10, beginning with verse 14, how can they call on him they have not believed in? And how can they believe without hearing about him? And how can they hear without a preacher? And the whole passage reminds us of this. In order for you and me to come to Christ, we have got to hear about the message of Christ. Before this world will come to Christ, it needs to hear the message of Christ. We hear. We didn't have the privilege like they did back then to saw him and they touched him and they smelled him. John tells us about this in 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. What was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, and what we have observed and touched with our hands concerning the word of life, the life was revealed and we have seen and it testified and we're declaring to you this eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. And we have seen and heard and also declare to you. Why? Because they saw, they touched, they smelled him. We have to hear about him. And those who hear about him are more blessed than those who touched him, than those who saw him, than those who smelled him. Jesus said that to Thomas. Thomas not being there that Sunday night when Jesus appeared to his disciples. They all told him, Jesus was here. And he says, I'm not going to believe until I touch the wounds in his hands and the wound in his side. And next Sunday night, Jesus appeared again to them. And this time Thomas is with them. And he says, check it out, Thomas. Thomas says, oh, I see now. And I believe. And Jesus said, more blessed are those who have not seen yet believe. Do you get that? You might think it was exciting to be back that day when Jesus was alive and teaching. Jesus says it's more exciting now. Because your greatest sense has now taken over a spiritual ear to hear. In Acts chapter 13, verse 44, the following Sabbath, almost the whole town assembled to hear the word of the Lord. But when Jews saw the crowd, they were filled with jealousy and began to contradict what Paul was saying, insulting him. Paul and Barnabas boldly replied, it was necessary for the word of God to be spoken to you first. Since you rejected and judge yourself unworthy of eternal life, we are turning to the Gentiles, for this is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles to bring salvation to the ends of the earth. You see, when you and I, as God's people, are united as one, we are then able to show them something different. If you have any idea of anything that's going on in the newspapers, magazines, or television, you understand that we live in a divided nation in a divided world. Don't you think people are looking for something different? And if they hang around us, we have the opportunity to do so. A united people. Do you think in just a few weeks when we conduct Faith Fair that we're going to attract people to Christ? We are sadly mistaken. If we think passing out food, providing games and prizes, and bringing out entertainment is what people are looking for and what they need, we're only fooling ourselves. But if we as a congregation, every single one of us, readjust our lives to serve in this capacity, to sign up and to be there, to be as one body, united, passing out hamburgers, passing out hot dogs, twirling things to make those fluffy little candies, what do you call them? Cotton candy. And playing games and dunking deacons and all that stuff. If we did it together, then people will say, who are all you people? I'll guarantee you right now, that's going to speak to a world. That is going to be a light to the Gentiles a lot more than passing out anything else during that whole day. It's God's kingdom, not ours. God has already established a way by which he's going to reveal himself to the world around us. And there's two things that jump out at me at scripture, and Jesus prayed before he left the earth. He said, Father, may they be one as we are one. And may they love one another like you and I love each other. Then the world will know that you came for me. He didn't say, if they go out to a park and pass out hot dogs and hamburgers, the world will know who I am. But we can use hot dogs and hamburgers in a park to show the world that we love each other and we're in this thing together. So let me encourage you to do something. Can you overcome your physical concerns and be able to be a part of that just during the day sometime? Can you overcome your schedules, your own plans, your own desires? If we do, folks, and we are united as one, you watch how God uses this fair this year. What a difference he will make. Because number two, it's for those who will also live it, the kingdom of God. They'll live it. Paul stayed 2 whole years. And what did Paul do those 2 whole years? He just welcomed all who visited him. And they sat down, they had dinner. And he proclaimed the kingdom of God, teaching about the Lord Jesus with all boldness and without hindrance. That's what we've been called to do. The book of Acts begins. You'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and to the ends of the earth. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. Then he said to them, go into the world and preach the gospel to all creation. You? No, all of you. In Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 and 20, Jesus came near and said to them, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I've commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the earth. And they said, some of us? And he said, no, all of you. Now here are some very serious words to consider. And I have to sit down. Tell you about them. this is going to rock our socks a little. In Romans chapter 11, verse 17, we read these words. Now remember I told you Israel was cut off and Gentiles were grafted in. It says in verse 17, now some of the branches were broken off, and you, the wild olive branch, were grafted in among them and have come to share in the rich root of the cultivated olive tree. Do not boast that you are better than these branches. He's basically saying to the Roman church, you as Gentile Christians, you need to understand that Israel was cut off from the olive tree. Made it possible for you to be grafted in. But you better not boast because you didn't earn this. It was offered to you so that you could be nurtured through Jesus. You see, the roots sustains you. Then that you will say, branches were broken off so that I might be grafted in. True enough, they were broken off because of unbelief. But you stand by faith. But do not be arrogant. Listen, but be aware, because if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Therefore, you know what the therefore? The therefore is to tell you this is what connects what happened before. Consider God's kindness and severity toward those who have fallen away, but God's kindness towards you, if you remain in his kindness. Otherwise, you too, I didn't write this. The Apostle Paul wrote it. He says, you too will be cut off. And even then, if they did not remain in unbelief, will be grafted in, because God has the power to graft them in again. People say, is God done with Israel? Of course not. Israel can come to the same way to Jesus and the kingdom as the rest of us, through the Lord Jesus Christ as their Messiah. God's not done with Israel. For if you were cut off from your native wild olive tree and against nature were grafted in a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these, the natural branches, be grafted in into their own olive tree? I don't want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so you will not be conceited. A partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come. And in this way, in what way? The fullness of the Gentiles. God will bring both Israel and Gentiles together as one. In this way, all sons and daughters of Abraham will be saved. I was thinking about Paul's house, and I close with this. What would you expect if you were in Paul's house? Would you say something to Paul as you began to teach about the kingdom of God? Paul, you can't teach that here. Paul said, wait a minute, this is my house. When people come to my house, I usually expect them to eat what's offered. I don't expect them to get up and fix something else. I expect them to accept the furniture the way I've arranged. I don't want them to change it. When people come to our church, what should they expect? They ought to expect the kingdom of God. A unified body of believers who loves one another and loves the Lord. And that God is using to change people's lives. They ought to feel like they're welcomed. One of the things I can say about Faith Baptist Church as I visit with those who come to our church, they say, your church is very welcoming. Good job, guys. Our church is very loving. Our church is full of servants. Our church is heading in the right direction. And I am confident that God is going to use this church for great things in the future. And I am so excited to be a part of it. Folks, I want to be a light. I want to be an attraction. I want to do it God's way. And the only way we can do it, we just can't tell God how we're going to run his kingdom. God's already established how he wants to run his kingdom. And now you and I have been called to be a part of it. And watch what he does with us. Watch what he does with us. Father, what a privilege. That you have given us. At what cost, when I consider the cross, and even the fact of Israel's rejection, that you've given us the privilege of being grafted into the family of God. And now we have the opportunity to share the hope of Jesus with those who so desperately need to hear. Father, make us one. Create in us the kingdom principles that you can use to change this world around us. That we will be faithful in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, discipling those who come to know Jesus, and going out into this world as your instruments. I thank you for what you're going to do in Faith Fair. I thank you, first and foremost, that you're going to draw us together as a body of believers to take this opportunity to serve this community and to share with them the hope that we have in Christ Jesus. We want to be available to you to use us for this purpose. May we be as one as we reach this community for you. Now, Father, if you're drawing someone to yourself today, may they respond to your grace, turning from their ways and enter themselves into the kingdom provided by Jesus. Lord, we give this invitation to you. Use it for your purpose in Jesus' name. Amen.